I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, now let us go into the house of the Lord. My feet shall stand within the gate. My feet shall stand within the gates. My feet shall stand within the gates. Now let us go into the house of the Lord. Now let us go into the house of the Lord. Now let us go into the house of the Join the flight of the Spirit. Come, lift your wings now and rise. For the promise of God is a life filled with light. Come away, why stay behind? Come fly. Come, join the song of the Spirit. Come, lift your voice now and sing. For the beautiful chorus will ring through the earth. Sing of love for you and for me. Come sing. Come join the dance of the Spirit, where steps have meaning and rhyme. Let us dance in the will of the one who has called upon our hearts to beat in time. Come dance. Come join the flight of the Spirit. Come lift your wings now and rise. For the promise of God is a life filled with flight. Come away, why stay behind? Come fly. Like the first morning, blackbird has spoken. Like the first bird, praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven. Like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness, of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the
all. Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Palo Alto. I'm glad everybody is here. As you know, today is our first time welcoming people back into the sanctuary. There's not very many people here, but it is okay. So we are glad you are here, no matter how you are showing up in the space, whether you are on Zoom somewhere, or whether you're here in the sanctuary. We are glad that you are here and taking some time to spend some time with us this morning. So again, welcome to First Presbyterian Church. We do have a few announcements for the life of the church, but as we begin this morning, as always, we encourage you to... Uh-oh, my screen just restarted. That's all right. we do have a few announcements, so make sure you subscribe to our back of the bulletin, our weekly email, as well as all of our socials. And then you want to make sure that you are on those so you can find out everything that's going on. You have all the links, all that kind of thing. This Wednesday, we encourage you to join us for Discover ACS, which is the Adolescent Counseling Services. They are doing a special... presentation about the work that they do. This is one of the organizations that we have supported during pandemic, and we have heard over and over again that young people are struggling with mental health issues, and so we want to make sure that we are part of that work, even work that we're not able to do ourselves. So make sure you save that time. They're doing this webinar especially for us, so we want to make sure that folks are there this Wednesday at 4 o'clock on Zoom, and all that information will be is available for you on all the places. Also, want to make sure that you have signed up for Lent. All the things that we're doing for Lent, those links will be in your chat. Couple of things big is you want to make sure you sign up so that you will get the devotional that is being sent out. That devotional is going to have something for every day. And then as well as you want to make sure that you get on that and look in your mail for Ash Wednesday supplies that are coming to you probably in the next week or two. Ash Wednesday is on March 2nd. And remember, this Lent we are talking about ashes and stardust, and we feel like there's been enough lament in the world, and so Kelly's going to lead us through some services that are going to rejoice also in who God has made us. So that means that on Sundays, beginning next Sunday, encourage you to join us as Kelly leads a Lenten series on Sunday afternoon. So make sure you sign up for that. Links will be in the chat for all of those things. The last part about Lent is we are having Jazz Vespers. Andy and Jonathan are going to join every Wednesday starting the 9th. Just a quick half hour of jazz. We'll do some poetry. and just a break in your day during Lent. So want to make sure that you see all of that. So again, Ash Wednesday is on the 2nd. Lent begins. It's amazing how quickly the calendar moves, but here we are. We will give you plans later about what we're going to do for Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, and Easter as we get those all done. After service today, we'll encourage you to go ahead and hang out in the Zoom. Sabrina will move you into breakout rooms. And then if you are here, you actually can feel free to, there is coffee out there today. The coffee per person is pretty high for the sanctuary people. You can each take like multiple cups today. But we encourage you, there's some tables out there. We can hang out and catch up from what's going on. All right. A few announcements again as we gather and we create this hybrid space we've been doing. Many of you are on Zoom and are going to stay on Zoom until you feel comfortable being in the space. But we are creating here. We still are asking people to mask and all those kind of things here. But a few reminders as we head into the Zoom place. For you all, your chat and your closed captioning in our video is always optional, so you can feel free to use that if you want, however you feel comfortable. We do record the entire service and put it on YouTube. The sermon is on Instagram, and we post that on Facebook. If you haven't seen the last few Sundays, we've tried a little something different with the sermon. There's a audio file that has you can listen to a little bit easier than before, so encourage you to pass those along to folks. If you are Zooming, you can still feel free to sing all you want. So sing boldly at home, but stay muted. And we do have tech deacons here to make sure that the chat and the space stays safe. If you are with us today in person, welcome. We're glad to see some of you that we haven't seen in a while. We are still maintaining all of our COVID precautions. As you know, Santa Clara County continues to have our mask mandate, and we are going to continue to follow that for the time being. We are in constant conversation about what we're going to be doing around COVID. We are still asking you to not sing, even when you're masked here today, but you can respond to the prayers that are in the bold. Service is pretty simple. There is, we have a small bulletin if you want to grab one when you're here, but there's nothing that will guide you through if you're on Zoom or here. Later on, we will do prayers, so we'll do Zoom, and then there's a microphone and camera here for any of you want to lift any prayers here in the sanctuary. And then I think lastly, we will have communion. So if you were at home, make sure that you, in the next 35 minutes or so, you go and get something to eat or drink to have communion. If you are here, hopefully you grabbed one of our communion packets there for later in the service. So I think that's it with all the announcements. We begin our time this Sunday, as we always do, with the ringing of the chime and a land acknowledgement, acknowledging that the land that we are on is stolen Indigenous land and that we commit to working towards resolution on that as we continue to be this community. We also ring the chime three times as just a reminder. There's lots going on, obviously, but just as focus points for our prayer time at the beginning. So we ring a chime for what's happening in Ukraine and continued. I know many of us are watching the news and keeping up with what is going on in Ukraine. We continue to lift up the Asian American community, and for a variety of reasons, a lot of anti-Asian hate crime. We also remember that internment declaration was this past week. So just continuing to remember the Asian American community. And we've heard of another young trans person that was murdered. And so we continue to lift up trans young people, especially folks who are rejected from community. And so we just want to lift up folks today in those three chimes. So I'm going to ring it three times. I encourage you to center yourself, listen to your breath, and just be in the silence today. So let's take some time for silence.
The opening prayer is by poet Harold C. Sandel. It's called Song. Love that is hoarded molds at last until we know someday the only thing we ever have is what we give away. And kindness that is never used but hidden all alone will slowly harden till it is as hard as any stone. It is the things we always hold that we will lose someday. The only things we ever keep are what we give away. Amen.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Give of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works with joy surround thee, earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee, center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Mortals join the happy chorus which the morning stars began. Love divine is reigning o'er us, joining all in heaven's plan. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us sunward in the triumph song of life.
Amen and amen. So now we join in confession, and in our tradition, we believe that we often bring things into the space that hold us back from experiencing God. And so we do that together, and then we do it individually. And how we do that is today, Caroline will read the one portion, and then I will read the all. And those of you here in the sanctuary and on Zoom, please join me in reading the all. So we'll have our confession, assurance, and then our passing of the peace. So let us now join together in our prayer of confession.
Like Joseph, we don't always understand why things happen the way they do, why our plans and dreams fail, and we find ourselves facing challenge after challenge, and disappointment after disappointment.
Like Joseph,
we strive to believe that you are at work in our lives.
God, forgive us when we only place trust in ourselves. Few moments for silent personal confession. May we receive the peace that Christ offers us.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Give us faith to trust in you. Give us courage to place our dreams in your hands and to follow where you lead. Give us peace knowing that your loving presence goes with us.
Sisters, brothers, siblings in Christ, choose to believe this day that in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, of the one called Jesus, we are forgiven and made new.
Let us be at peace with ourselves and with all we meet.
Amen.
Amen.
So if you are visiting with us today, now we do a little thing of passing of the peace. So what happens is those are on Zoom. We're going to scroll through and say hello and pass the peace with each other. Those in the space here, you can feel free to stand and wave and do whatever we need to do to pass the peace in here. We'll hear everybody and we'll do that for a few minutes and then we'll hear scripture. So let's pass the peace of Christ to one another.
Hi, Rita.
Hi, everybody.
Good morning,
everyone.
Hi, Greer.
Hi,
nice puppet.
Hi.
Hi,
Caroline.
I love Melissa.
Hi, Evelyn. Hi, Margaret.
Hi, Cindy.
Hi, Greer.
Wonderful to see
you.
Hi,
Lucas.
Hi, Jan.
Hi, Evelyn.
Hi,
Watson.
Hi.
Hi, Craig.
Hi, Martha.
Hi,
Megan.
Hi, John.
Hi, Greer.
Hi, Martha.
Hi, Elliot.
Hi.
Hi, Ellen.
Hi, Eleanor.
Hi, Susan.
Hi, Suki and Watson.
Sure, from Carolyn.
All right, this morning's reading comes from Genesis. Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm Joseph. Is my father really still alive?" His brothers couldn't respond because they were terrified before him. Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me," and they moved closer. He said, "I'm your brother Joseph, the one you sold to Egypt. Now, don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves that you sold me here. Actually, God sent me before you to save lives. We've already had 2 years of famine in the land, and there are 5 years left without planting or harvesting. God sent me before you to make sure you'd survive and to rescue your lives in this amazing way. You didn't send me here. It was God who made me a father to Pharaoh, master of his entire household, and ruler of the whole land of Egypt. Hurry, go back to your father. Tell him this is what your son Joseph says. God has made me master of all in Egypt. Come down to me, don't delay. You may live in the land of Goshen, so you will be near me, your children, your grandchildren, your flocks, your herds, and everyone with you. I will support you there. So you, your household, and everyone with you won't starve, since the famine will still last 5 years. He kissed all of his brothers and wept, embracing them. After that, his brothers were finally able to talk to him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen. All right, so let's have just a word of prayer. Let us pray. God, for the spirit that is in this place, the spirit that continues to move us to give us first breath in the morning, we give you thanks. We would ask that you would be in this place, in this space that in which we gather to continue to challenge us to be faithful in the world, to be a loving presence, a just presence, and a people who continue to make connections between humanity and you, O God. We thank you for the spirit that has brought us here today. May that same spirit guide the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts so they're acceptable to you. We pray all of this in the name of Christ, and God's people say, amen. So if anybody of you follow us on Facebook or on Instagram or Twitter and all the places, you'll see we got some comments this week about the title of this sermon, The Grudges Are Fun. Last week we got, probably last week's sermon on the resurrection, we got a lot of interaction and response from our worship last week, but this past week we put something out on Fridays that says here's what the sermon in the scripture is going to be, and we got a little bit of feedback, because I think people were wondering, like, so is this going to be a pro-grudge sermon, or is like, what, are we going to be anti-grudge? So to be clear, we are not pro-grudge, but also to be clear, we know that sometimes grudges, they actually make life easier. Sometimes they can be fun. Sometimes they can, especially if you feel like you've been wronged, like you feel justified in holding a grudge. If you don't want to deal with somebody because you maybe feel wronged, holding a grudge allows you to not deal with, there's lots about this that I think that makes sense for us and sometimes makes grudges something we hold. I need to remind you all that I've shared before, my family, like, we take grudge holding to an Olympic level sport. Like, my grandmother, Grandma Reyes, who I've mentioned before, it's no surprise to you, was like a serious grudge holder, held grudges for years for people with people, and I don't know where she got it from. I don't know if maybe that personality helped to kind of help her survive the world, but she was a grudge holder, and that was passed down to my mother, who we watched do that, and then every once in a while, I'll see that in myself, and I will call my mom and say, thanks, Mom, because it's been passed down to me. I hope that it's diluted with every generation, and I hope that we haven't, we can kind of lessen it. But there are times where we can kind of see that holding a grudge makes some sense. Every time I hear this Joseph story, you have to think about who are you in the story, but also, like, how would you respond to any of this, right? If you think about it literally and you think about the actuality of it, we are stepping into the space of the story now that is really much more, we're having technical difficulties. That's all right. Okay, we're cool. Thanks. Where was I? Oh, yeah, sorry. So with the story about Joseph and his brothers, right, you hear this story about, well, the brothers have decided they're jealous of Joseph because Joseph is one of the father's favorites, so they're going to cast him into this hole, or they were actually going to let him die. They were going to leave him and let him die. Well, Reuben takes mercy upon Joseph, says, no, let's not just outright kill him. Let's leave him in the hole, as if, oh, that Reuben, that's such a, you're the good son, right? I mean, and then, but so if you were to think about all these things, like, there's no brother that is good in this story because we all let this happen. So in this case, we kind of step out of this metaphoric, right? We kind of step back and we think about what does it mean for people to be jealous and move to the point where, you've taken major actions against somebody. And so we have Joseph, who is the second to youngest. Does anybody remember who the youngest one is? Benjamin, there you go. Gold stars for Pat, right? So Benjamin is the youngest. So they're jealous not because they're the youngest, they're getting extra attention. They're jealous because the father has shown favor with Joseph, all that. So now flash forward many, many years, right? Joseph now is in the Pharaoh's court and has achieved power and authority, and is now kind of fulfilled these things that God has said. And the brothers now come, and initially, they don't recognize him, and then they do. Now, most of us probably put ourselves in Joseph's feet. in Joseph's shoes, right? Could you imagine if anybody did something terrible to you? I mean, not even getting to the point of just leaving you in a hole to die, right? Really, really bad. And, you know, what would our reactions be? What have your reactions been when somebody has wronged you so much that you, you know, like, I can't imagine really being Joseph. Now, some would say, well, Joseph was fine now, right? Joseph could kind of be magnanimous because Joseph won in some way. So he's like, I can be magnanimous now because, you know, I have all this authority. I'm seeing the future, all these things. So I can show a little compassion. But, you know, I don't think I could be that magnanimous. I mean, I don't know if any of you could. If somebody left me to die in a hole, I don't care how much power I have or anything later on, I can't imagine that I'd be like, no, it's good. Like, it all worked out. I just don't think that I could be in that space. And yet Joseph does. And so what I get out is, in many ways, that Joseph is saying to them, and this is the crux of this story for me, is that Joseph talks about God moving with Joseph through all of this. Now, I am not one that believes God intentionally places us in these kind of tumultuous, violent spaces just so we can come out better. I believe God's with us as these things happen. But Joseph is reminding them that God was with Joseph through all of this. And so, part of this forgiving that Joseph does is in many ways removing anything that would hold back his brothers from experiencing God themselves. And if Joseph held on to that grudge, if Joseph held on to this idea that the brothers were not worth feeding and protecting and acknowledging, Joseph too would be held back from experiencing God in his life. So when I take this story, I always think about, what's the part about this forgiving or allowing these things to happen? And the important part of what that means for us is that oftentimes these things sit within our souls and it holds us back from experiencing God's fullness in our lives or in the lives of others. I say that for two reasons. One, how it affects us, right? Again, Joseph, if he would have held on to that, I mean, you know what it's like. You probably have somewhere in your hole, in your spirit, where you are holding on to a grudge or an anger, and it sneaks up on you sometimes, and you didn't even know it was there. But when it comes up, you just don't feel good about how that makes you feel. I think that's always our disconnect from God, that we are in some ways not allowing ourselves to connect to a larger divinity and presence in the world. That when I'm holding such anger against somebody, that in some ways that does not allow me to acknowledge the divinity in another person. Now, it doesn't mean that I approve of what they did or I'm letting them off the hook, but it does mean that I'm not gonna hold that so much that it begins to eat away at my own soul and spirit. So in some ways, I get Joseph, right? He could just hold on to that, and we would all say, you are totally justified in just being angry all the time at your brothers. In fact, you would be justified if you did things to them. They left you in a hole to die, and that's only because Reuben, the kind brother, said, let's not just kill him outright. So we would say, Joseph, you have every reason, but Joseph doesn't. He lets it go. Which is something that I think allows him to continue to live into this narrative and story that he has said that God has been with him. So it allows him to continue to experience a connection to God that holding on to that, he would not be able to. And then you have the brothers, right? Who come in some ways fearful, but I think, you know, situation has forced them to want to be forgiven, to want to be in some way given some release from this thing that they have done. And I don't know about you, but that is a terrible place to be. If any of you have ever known that you have wronged somebody and what that does to your spirit and your soul, knowing that you did something wrong. What does it mean for us to sit with that for so long? And what does it mean when we're with that person or that community and we have to acknowledge that we've wronged somebody in a way that is genuine, right? Not the apologies that are like, I'm sorry that this happened to you, like as if we didn't have any, I mean, not these apologies that are really not about like acknowledging our participation in hurt, but really deeply to say to somebody, what I did harmed you, brought you pain. As a person of faith, what I did disconnected you from an experience of the holy in a way that I got in the middle of that. And so you have the brothers who are seeking to find some way, some absolution to this thing that I choose to believe has probably been eating them up for their entire lives. And so they come to Joseph. And who knows, right? They too are probably thinking Joseph has every right to not offer us forgiveness. And yet they come to him and they simply offer themselves, which is what I think is what we should be hearing from this story, is that we simply offer ourselves almost without assumption about what is returned. For the crux for me for forgiveness, if it's truly meaningful, if I were the brothers and I was seeking forgiveness for a wrong that I did, I'm going to seek that without expectation of being forgiven. I'm going to seek that because it is about my connection to God, not about approval even of the other person. Because what's happened in our society is I think we have made forgiveness and apologies transactional. We've created this commodifying of this of apologizing and forgiving, so much so that it's like, if I do this, then you should do this, and I'm not going to do this unless you're going to do this. So I'm not going to apologize unless you're going to forgive me. Well, that's not a true apology then, right? Because that is just an exchange you're commodifying a relationship. And so for me, what we hear out of this story is this purity in many ways of the brothers simply coming and saying, we place ourselves at your feet. We apologize. We are wrong for what we did. And you have Joseph that just simply says, okay. And for me, you don't hear like, if you do this, then I'll do this. If you, like, there's no reciprocation that is guaranteed or sought. It's simply people coming together and trying in their best way to make clear the way for God to be present. If we can get to that in the world, how much better would the world be? If we could get to the point in our individual relationships where we have wronged somebody and we simply go and acknowledge that wrong without the expectation that anything else happens, if we can simply be in a space where when we have been wronged, that we can simply let that go, and not, again, we're not letting people off the hook or not holding people accountable, but we are simply not going to hold on to that anger in a way that destroys our own spirit. How much less tired would we be? How much more joyful could we be? And most importantly, how much more can we see what God hopes for us in the world? This story is about just that, a cleansing of relationship so that they can see the future that God bestows upon them. They know there will be struggle, but Joseph tells them that even through that famine, on the other side, there is the promised land and there is new life and there is hope. And so if we can let this part of our relationship go in a way that no longer holds us back from experiencing God together, then we together move into that new day. Now, it's not easy for us to do, especially with people who are close to us and our families. It's not easy to do, especially in congregations that have been together for so long. It's not easy to do in work spaces where you have these weird, funky relationships. It's not easy to do with extended family or extended community. But yet, when we can get to that space where we kind of just let that stuff stop eating at us, how much more clearly can we see God's future for us. And conversely, when we hold on to it so tightly that that is the lens through which we can see the future, it will be cloudy and it will not be clear. And I believe while God will still be with us, it will be more and more difficult for us to see where God is leading. So I encourage you this next week to tend to those spaces in your soul where you might be holding a grudge, holding back your experience of God, as well as those places where maybe you might need to step into a place of seeking forgiveness or acknowledging hurt. And by addressing all of that in our souls, individually and communally, maybe we'll see where God is leading us. Let us pray. God, for the Spirit that moves us, the Spirit that challenges us and makes us uncomfortable, but the Spirit that is always with us, we give you thanks. We ask that you would continue to move through and amongst us as we tend and mend relationships in our lives so that we may all more fully see what you are calling us to be and who you're calling us to be in the world. We thank you for the Spirit this day and for those gathered in this space as we continue to struggle and rejoice in being your people. We pray all of this in the name of Christ, and all God's people say,
Amen.
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O Thou of God, to earth come down. Thee will I cherish, Thee will I honor, Thou my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Fair are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Beautiful Savior, ruler of the nations, Son of God and Lord of all, glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore.
Amen and amen. Thank you, Elliot and Andy, as always. We are now into our time of offering and special music and responding to the word. We are, again, always grateful that this community has been so generous during this time of pandemic. And so we encourage you to continue to support what is happening in this ministry, the ways in which we support organizations and individuals outside of our community, as well as we have a facility and your staff and all that. So we are grateful for your continued giving. You can do that online, or you can continue to mail check in, however is easiest and more comfortable for you. In a minute, just to give you a heads up, we have a special music from Matt Black. So Matt has been with us before. Matt is remote, coming to us from the Monterey area today. So Matt will do our special music, and then we'll have communion. So if you those of you in the sanctuary haven't grabbed your communion packet, there's some in the back there, as well as those of you at home. This is a time to quickly go get your something to eat or drink. and join us for communion. So with that, I would welcome Matt again to the community for some special music.
If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, right hand will hold me fast.
Amen and amen. Thank you, Matt. So glad to have you with us again. Again, thank you for that. We're now going to have our prayers of the people. So the way that we do that is I'll lift a few prayers for our community, and then I'll hand it off to Cindy, and Cindy will call on folks who are on Zoom. So if you're on Zoom, remember to go ahead and use your raise hand reaction there so that you can get called on, and then you'll lift those prayers up. And then after that, we'll come back into here, and if any of you here in the sanctuary today have any prayers, you can step up to the microphone and we can share those out. So a few prayers for us. Would ask for deep prayers for Francis Young. Francis is in the hospital being treated for an infection, so we want to continue to pray for Francis. We want to continue to pray for Marvin Lamphere, who was hospitalized again. You know, Marvin's had some health stuff going on, and is dealing with another bout from his heart. And prayers for Christine, his daughter, who is able to be with him. And Marvin is back home at Brookdale, but we want to continue to lift up healing and comfort for Marvin. We continue to pray for healing for Via. Via and I hung out a little bit this week, and so just continue to pray for Via's leg and her healing. And we want to give continued Thanksgiving prayers for Mary Alice Thornton, who continues to make modest speech and mobility progress. And you know, this has been a long journey, so we continue to pray for her and rejoice in the progress she's made from her stroke, and then also to continue to pray for Dave as he cares for and supports Mary Alice. All right, so I think that's it for our initial prayers. So I'll hand it over to Cindy for our prayers from Zoom.
There's some hands ups. Good. Cindy Chin Lee, you go first.
Thank you. A prayer of thanks for the life of my sister-in-law, Diane Didi Chin Lee. We had our Zoom memorial yesterday night, and with a few glitches, everything went very well, and it was a good way to gather family and friends to honor her life.
Thank you, Cindy. Next, Vida, go ahead.
First, prayers for the Gonzalez family. One of the Gonzalez brothers, John Gonzalez, is the godfather to our grandchildren, Nathan and Lillian. His twin brother has just entered hospice about a week and a half ago. So the whole family is very distressed. And John has gone to Southern California to be with his brother. And being twins, if any of you are twins, I'm not, by the way, but you probably understand how close that relationship is and how deeply upset John is. I'd like to end on a happier note, though, and that is that I had my last of the in-person post-operative meetings on Friday, and I am cleared to go back up to my mountain home, and that's what Lauren and I are doing this afternoon. Bill and Steve and the kids are already up there because of ski week coming up, and the kids are already probably on the slopes learning how to ski. So, sorrow and thanksgiving in my prayers.
Thank you, Vida. Next, Susan Chamberlain.
Yes, I want to lift up prayers for Jesse's baby. He is entering the last 6 weeks before the delivery, expected delivery, and just prayers for his health as he grows a lot in these last 6 weeks, and that just the going is smooth for him, and prayers for Jess that she, you know, as she's heading into this last stage of the journey of pregnancy, and that she just knows all the love and support that surrounds her.
Thank you, Susan and Jess.
Thanks, Mom.
Next, John Rickford.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
I have an unusual prayer for a search in our department for a sociolinguist. That is, we've just had 4 finalists, and it's partly to replace me and replace another colleague because our program has been reduced to 1 from 3 people. So I pray for this search in particular because now they, not essentially me because I'm retired, have to make a critical decision about who to hire. And as I said in my book, I was the last underrepresented minority member to be hired 40 years ago in our department. And there are some good candidates, and I pray that the search will result in a conclusion where we actually hire somebody. The last time we didn't. So please pray for the Department of Linguistics in this important search.
Thank you, John. Next is Lee Merkel-Raymond.
First, I see Khwaja. Khwaja, can you nod if you hear me? Can I share the news that Suki has returned? You're on mute. Do you want to talk?
Okay.
Go ahead, Lee.
Okay, I was just going to say that Suki Choi went to Kilimanjaro and climbed successfully and made it home safely. And you can see the smile on Khwaja's face that he has returned safely.
Mm-hmm. He's not here yet. He's coming home this afternoon.
Mm-hmm. Congrats to him.
Thank you, Lee and Khwaja. That's the last of the yellow hands. Does anybody want to wave your hand for a prayer? Let me see if I can see any. I see Via. Go ahead, Via.
I wanted to thank those prayers for my leg. It is getting better. I can stand up briefly using it with support, but I don't think I will be able to walk, but I really appreciate I have gotten so far. So thank you.
All right, thank you, Via. Let's see if there are any more hands waving. I don't see any more, so Bruce, it's you again.
All right, thank you all. There's so much going on in this community. You know, we're not a big church, but babies being born that folks may didn't even know that Jesse was having a baby, to Suki dropping in a meeting just like, oh, I'm going to go climb Mount Kilimanjaro next week kind of thing. So the whole span of things, as well as loss and all of that. So for those of you on Zoom, thank you for being able to share that. Make sure that you do look in the chat for some of those prayers so that we can continue to share in prayer. We have a couple of prayers that will happen here in the sanctuary. So let's go ahead and spotlight the prayer cam here. And Jim, feel free.
I'd like to offer a couple of prayers. One for my mother-in-law who fell and broke her hip and is struggling with rehab, but also I would say maybe struggling with depression and the motivation to get up and do the rehab. She's just really having a hard time with that right now. And then also prayers for my wife's nephew who had gone through drug rehabilitation and went clean for a couple of years and now has relapsed and is trying to get back and find a good rehab program. So prayers for both of them.
Jim, does anybody else want to go ahead and Jim? You can the other Jim. With so few people here, we have two Jims. Who would have ever thought? Go ahead, Jim. Jim H.
Well, this is a prayer of asking for help. I seem to be a very stubborn person in a surprising way, and there's something that I want to do, and I'm having the deepest difficulty in admitting to myself things that I, problems that I have in myself that hold me back from making what I think is a good, taking a good action. And I just pray that somehow I can get beyond grudges and get beyond whatever it is that is resentments or hoarding or whatever negative quality I'm trying to deal with to do something that I think is the correct thing to do.
Great. Thank you, Jim. All right, any other prayers from in here? All right, let's join in prayer, and then we'll join together in the Lord's Prayer and then have communion. So let us pray. God, we thank you for all that has been brought into this space, from rejoicing about new life that is about to enter the world, and for health that is being experienced, and for the ways in which you show your peace and your hope and your justice. We give you thanks. You've also heard great prayers of loss and of struggle in body, mind, and spirit for things that we need to figure out how to move through or around, to struggles that have come back, to loss of life, to just all the ways in which our human souls experience grief and suffering. God, we ask that you remind us that we need not hold all of these things on our own. That being part of community means that we hold these things together, and being part of community that is grounded in you, that you hold all of it more than we could do even ourselves. For all those places deep in our souls that are still too tender for us to lift up with our voices or to share in any way, we ask that you remind us that you are there. And for those things that are just burgeoning from our lips that are about joy and celebration, remind us that you are there as well. For us, as we continue to walk this journey of faith, remind us of the presence of Christ in the world, and that Christ walked with and among us, suffered, rejoiced, experienced all the things that we do, and also came to the table and was fed and fed others. And that is what we are called to this and every day. So it is in the name of the one called Christ that we pray together. Our Creator in heaven, holy is your name. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So we are going to have communion now. So if you are at home, go grab whatever you are going to eat or drink. And if you are here, hopefully you have your communion pod that we have. There is no good name for these. Lunchable, I don't know. I will use this for us in the sanctuary, and the next week I'll do bread, and we'll try to alternate back and forth. But what we do know is that Jesus was at the table. It doesn't matter what the food was in its particular form, but that Jesus took ordinary food and sustenance, blessed it, made it holy, and it fed us. And so we do know that Jesus, when he came to the table, and if you pull off the first layer there, he took the bread of the people, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, take, eat. Every time that you do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Every time that you drink of this, do this in remembrance of me. For every time that we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. My friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. So as you feel called, partake in the bread and the cup. And let us pray. God, for the grace that surrounds us, the grace that is beyond even our own imagination, for the ways in which you speak into the world and into our souls, we give you thanks. The world is heavy and the weight is much upon our souls these days, but together we hold them up together through the body and through this cup. The body reminding us that we are connected to one another beyond what we would normally choose to do. The cup reminding us that we are promised a new day, that even out of despair and struggle, there is hope and new life. Let these things nourish us for the week, nourish us for the days ahead and for our entire lives, so that we may step into the world as your servants. We pray all of this in the name of Christ, and all God's people say,
Amen. Amen.
So in a minute, those of you on Zoom will get broken up into your breakout rooms. Those of us that are in this space, you can feel free to hang out. There's coffee out there. Andy's actually going to play a little bit after service this time. And then breakout rooms will happen. If you can't stay for breakouts and you're on Zoom, we're glad you're here. And you've carved out some time. I also want to give special thanks to Sabrina, who we had multiple cameras decide not to work today, getting everything going. Sabrina is, today was going to be her last Sunday, but I sent a very pathetic text and said, can I beg you to stay one more Sunday because I'm not here next Sunday. So Sabrina will be here one more Sunday. Matthew is training to be able to take Sabrina's place. And so I'm grateful for those behind the scenes that continue to do the work that we are doing. So make sure at some point, those of you that are here, you give your thanks. All right, your charge and benediction are this, to go forth into the world with compassion and justice in your hearts, hear voices of the long silenced, see strength in that which has been deemed weak, see one another, hear one another, care for one another, and love one another. It's all that easy, and it's all that hard. Now may the grace of God and the love of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore, and all God's people say, Amen. Go in peace.